So good morning. What I would like to share with you today is not purely my own research, but as mentioned Christopher, more some results, collaborative results from this project, from this Colupsia project. It was a multidisciplinary research and development project, I insist, and development project, it's not very common at C4, centered around the process of integrated natural resource management. A partnership with two research institutions, CIRAD, C4, two national NGOs, and also two local NGOs, and two Indonesian universities. We work at landscape level. We work in two regencies, Kapuasulu in West Kalimantan, and Maluku Tengah, central Maluku, in Seram Island, in the eastern part of Indonesia. Our boundary partner were BAPEDA, the regional agency for planning and development in Indonesia, Ministry of Forestry, Ministry of Agriculture, and also other NGOs. So one important element, very important element of integrated natural resource management is spatial planning. Spatial planning, it's a cross-sectoral, multi-level, multi-scale process as well, where maps and also distribution of responsibilities are very crucial. In terms of spatial planning in Indonesia, you have a lot of shortcomings, a lot of issues. Overlapping authorities, you have a lack of coordination between sectors, but also within sectors themselves. The policy of land use are very often driven by political agenda and or big business. You have a lot of potential territorial conflict between customary land and also and state land. Ecosystem functions or services are never considered in such kind of process. And also it's, as you probably know, it's a very, very top-down process, especially very top-down process in terms of mapping. So in terms of mapping land allocation or what we call land zoning. This present land zoning in Indonesia has a lot of shortcomings, mainly because it's made at a very imprecise scale, at least for the regency level. We use 250,000, they use 250,000 scale. So it's a lack of detail and it's very difficult to match the unit that they propose on the maps and the reality in the ground, like topography or vegetation. It's also supported by very poor biophysical data. And it's mainly based on what we call an index called Forest Score, which has been done on very general data in the 80s, and it was mainly intended for national level only. So this is still, there is no revision of this process so far. And this makes decision making for spatial planning and land zoning in Indonesia, especially at the regency level, very inefficient, and especially not data supported. It has quite a lot of impact on decision, of course, but also research, especially when you deal with issues of forest management units, or let's say logging concession versus conservation area, or alpine plantation versus forest state land. All these make all the debate very inefficient. So to tackle these issues, we developed this Colupsia project with the main objectives to develop an engagement strategy with key stakeholders of spatial planning, to improve the communication linkages between decision level, and also to improve capacity of the key stakeholders in preparing participatory development actions. And finally, to improve the quality of social ecological data in line with large-scale mapping and this need of more precise or new revised land zoning and our decision model for the Regency level. In terms of governance, our results confirm the complete disconnection between the spatial planning agency and what we call the land data provider, means forestry, agriculture, mining, water management, and also a tendency among planners to secure the property right and interest of elite groups. So we introduce what we call a foresighting approach, what we call a participatory prospective analysis, to try to engage, to enhance the engagement of stakeholders in the process. And we were quite successful, I think, in this establishment of a progressive dialogue among stakeholders, along in parallel with the results, the progress of the project, for the development of potential scenario of what could happen for their future, based on what they consider, not us, as very influential variable on the land management of their own land use and management. To finally facilitate with them establishment of a consensus between the stakeholders in terms of what they wish to develop for their future in terms of land management. So this is important because our own project has to adjust also to what they really wish. For the social dimension, we develop guidelines for socioeconomic survey of households, supplemented by a focus group discussion mainly on land tenure and rights. And we also develop guidelines for potential assessment of potential payment for environmental services. In terms of environment, we use various satellite products to produce land cover maps at 1 to 50,000 scale, so very detailed map. You have more than 50 classes of vegetation. And it's also including often participatory mapping with communities, especially when we work at the border of national parks. We sample a lot of forest types, not only primary forest, but also secondary forest, secondary vegetation, and also agroforestry system, mixed garden. So we have a lot of permanent plots, like 25 hectares in Kapuasulu and like 15 hectares in Seram, where we perform our ecological work. We work mainly on biodiversity of trees, but also biomass. We do some soil survey, especially we look at problem of soil erosion and a bit of hydrology, where we try to improve the data sets on rainfall, river flow, and water quality, which are always very poor in such remote area. So among some of the results that I can share with you that deal more with the management of natural resources, I think first, during this project time, we get a lot of new data on tree species distribution. That's quite important for all the policies on conservation, of course. For instance, from the 7,000 plus herbarium collection, you know, this little box that you find in my office and sometimes in the corridor, we identified more than 1,200 tree species only for Kapuasulu. For Kapuasulu alone, you have already 1,200 species of trees. That's quite amazing. For instance, in France, you have only 140 maximum. Yeah. So 1,200 species, and even we don't collect yet in the mountains. Also, we discover not new forest type, but newly recorded for this area, like Kerangas forest or Kerapa forest, which was in the past more known for Sarawak, and also in Seram, a lot of data on limestone forest and new specific swamp forest there. The second aspect is the development of this land zoning, revision of this land zoning at large scale. So what we did, we want to use the same forest score like the Ministry of Forestry, so they don't complain that we use another method. But we applied it to large scale, detailed data set on large scale and maps. And we come up with a complete a new classification of more precise classification of forest function category, like forest production forest, conservation protection forest, and so on. And it has a dramatic change on the way you can discuss about spatial planning in such area. For instance, in CERAM, if you take only the protected forest, Hutan Lindung, we go from 22% at a scale of 1 to 250,000 for this area, to more than 50% of Hutan Lindung if we go at 50,000 scale. This is due of the fact that we have much better data on slope. But of course, it's a huge, huge debate when you announce to the local government that you have now 50% of your areas that's supposed to be under protection of watershed. So I think this land zoning revision, and together with a large-scale land cover map, are maybe one of among the best impacts that we can get from this project to the Ministry of Forestry and to BAPEDA also in provincial level. It has also a direct link with the One Map initiative that you hear in Indonesia. I don't know if it's still in the air, but it's exactly, we have this experience that it will be maybe good to share with the people brainstorming on the One Map initiative. So some lesson learned maybe through this, I believe that through this integrated natural resource management process, this Colutia project, and especially using this participatory prospective analysis, succeed as an efficient operational framework for exploration and anticipation of changes. It leads to better coordination between sectors. It brings a bottom-up approach to national level, bringing some results, local results, to national level. At the same time, it takes into account local community needs and also local government. We try to combine both. But of course, you still have a lot of challenges. It is still a learning process for stakeholders to work together and to try to decide together on the best way how to achieve their common vision for the future. There is a long-term local, lack of long-term local commitment. Also, as you know, it's always very difficult to engage with private company. So we were not very successful on that one. And also we wanted to demonstrate or to promote this idea of bottom-up approach to national level. We have to confess that when we were discussing at national level, you can see very well they are not so much in favor of this idea. Monitoring also during we don't have time enough, I feel, to get a proper monitoring program in place. And I think it's a general problem of this integrated natural resource management project. Very often, 3 years, 4 years, it's not enough. I feel it will be a period of 7 to 8 years. And it's something, again, that we need to negotiate with donors. And as far as I know, they are not so much in favor of this much long-term project. So to conclude, I think it will be interesting to continue such kind of large-scale approach and detailed mapping at regency level to try to aggregate now more regencies to demonstrate now to the province level how they can improve their data set and the map themselves as a province instead of receiving data from Jakarta. Also, I think we must explore more carefully this governance linkages between local, provincial, and national level. I think there is something that we don't understand fully in that respect. That's why we have difficulties even producing a lot of work at the national level to really get this impact. There is something that we still need to explore. And probably we must get more engagement with not only local level, but again, maybe a bit more with national level. For instance, with the NARS, the National Agricultural Research System, but also other government agencies. For instance, at CIFOR we work, of course, and this project also with FORDA, but I think for a land use planning project, spatial planning, we should work absolutely more directly with Baplan, for instance. Also, I think, again, starting from what I said at the beginning, I think if we can keep some links with development, with a development agency for this kind of project, I think it will we will have a better impact. If we can keep with a technical aspect of forestry, silviculture, I think it will be easier to get an impact. Okay, but for now, also there is much more we can say about integrated natural resource management, and also there is a lot more of results from this Colluxia project that maybe we can share later on. For the time being, I think I arrived to my to the end of my time slot, so I would like first to thank you, and I am open for any questions.
Okay, thank you very much. Land use planning, not an easy task in many countries, and certainly here compounded by many more factors. It's not only data, it's, as you've seen, it's also trying to get an understanding for these processes and getting the right partners on board and the right processes going. The floor is open for comments and questions. Anybody? Yes, please.
Thank you, Yves. It's interesting presentations. You mentioned you develop maps. So my question is, at what level this map established? Is it the provincial, district, or the size? And what would be the difference within the process in the land use planning that can be applied by government? Because they also involve many stakeholders in the process. And it could change within 5 years when the political agenda changes also. So I'm also questioning what would be the effectively of this approach, because I guess it would be required very high cost if you want to see the details, and what would be the scaling up for the national level. Thank you.
Well, I think first these kind of maps were done at regency level. Yeah, I prefer regency and district than district and sub-district. So regency level, all regency is covered by map at 50,000 scale. And why we do that? Because we realize that with the previous land zoning, it was very difficult to discuss with people in the field. And in Indonesia, you have a good, at least existing data set of digital data at 50,000 scale from Bako Sortana. So the idea was to go to that scale at that time. And we already had some experience in previous project on going to larger scale like that. So it's available. I mean, it's what we discussed with the Ministry of Forestry. It's available. For instance, at the Ministry of Forestry, they can do exactly what we do. So to produce this kind of detailed land cover map, at least for the Ministry of Forestry, is something very important. If they want to discuss again or maybe a revised forest score, that's the only way for the time being to categorize forest function, and it will be always important in the discussion between all the sectors. I think forest department, I don't see as in the future becoming less important for that, maybe more coordination with the other, but the Kawasan Hutan and all the relation with forest land and this zoning, I think it will remain important. So if they can themselves endorse this kind of mapping and use it and promote it in discussion with other ministry, I think they will be the winner, because in 2013, it's not because of project, but in 2013, the 50,000 scale become legally the official scale at the regency level. So we are the first to propose already a complete data set for some regencies, where people can see the advantage of having this kind of approach. Yeah. And then I mentioned the One Map initiative. That's exactly that. I think it's one, if Ministry of Forestry, not us, but all with us, can promote this with a group of people working on One Map initiative, I think we should do it. And European Union, who was funding this project, is very much in favor if we can do such kind of thing. And we reach here the another issue, whether it's after the end of this project, should I continue myself to go to Ministry of Forestry, or who is going to do that now to continue to do this advocacy work?
Thanks, Pak, for sharing your experience with Kolupsia. You mentioned about participatory mapping process, and I would like to know, did you experience any dispute in the form of perhaps local community claim that this is their traditional tenurial area, and then there's a company, maybe mining or plantation, that also claim that this is already within their concession? And when you experience this kind of dispute, what kind of role that Kolupsia took at that moment? Thank you.
Yes, thank you. Actually, yes, we experience a lot of this situation. I can take one example in Seram about the national Manusena National Park. So you have already several boundaries of this national park, several revisions, and the last one was year 99 or 2000, something like that. And suddenly in 2011, so during the life of this project Kolupsia, from Jakarta, they make a revision of the boundary of the park, but they do it only from Jakarta. So on the map, you have a new border, which is a bit bigger, and one exactly in one part of the park, suddenly all the gardens of a particular village are included in the park. Huge one, huge area. And of course, it's a conflict with this village. But instead of trying to discuss about how to probably come back to the field and discuss with people, they try to reinforce this map. So suddenly all the gardens were, the people were told that now they cannot go to their garden, just they can still collect durian or whatever, but they should not clean a bit their garden, they should not do anything in their garden. So of course, they end up with a huge, huge conflict. Yeah. And when we see this from the ecological perspective, why you wanted to include this, it's a steep slope, for instance, but we were able to show that the local way of doing garden in that area are very, very ecological minded, with a lot of trees everywhere, and so it's absolutely not an issue. Biodiversity is there. Actually, there are a lot of discussions like that with Ministry of Forestry and Authority of the Park to just acknowledge this kind of very strict conservation is not the way to go. So it's one example. We have also other example of people, interesting example of people, and every time you will find a report of one of my students on this one. The other one I like is also in Seram, it's about traditional land of people, huge one, because they still have a king in that area, it's a huge territory. A national company for cocoa who leases the land for a period of 30 years, and at least they want to renew the lease, and local people of the village decide no, they don't want anymore. The king himself doesn't want too much, so there is a lot of conflict between the company and the people. At the same time, you have a friend of the king who opened a new logging company in the Hutan Lindung, so all this relation is quite interesting, and every time our maps are taken by many people there to discuss. Yeah? And because it shows different forest types, it's based on elevation of zonation of vegetation, it shows where are the gardens, which type of gardens. So there is a lot of information that people can understand and use for this kind of debate. In some area, also, we have conflict between village themselves because they claim the same area. In that case, when we do participatory mapping, we don't map a boundary in such place. Yeah, it's like a place that they have to discuss.
Okay, my question goes back a little bit to what Dede already asked, and it's about, you said several times, we are improving data sets, or to improve data sets. I wonder how that physically looks. Are you going with a bag full of data to the Ministry of Forestry, to the Regency? Is there an open access database from the government where you can just link in and improve? So how does this improving data sets physically look like?
Okay, so first you have all the mapping aspects, so it's more kind of GIS way of handling the data. In that case, we all the government institutions have a GIS section, so we just give the data to mainly to Department of Forestry, but also to BAPEDA. At the national level, it's not too much an issue. We just give the data. At the regional, especially the regency level, it's much more complicated because we need also capacity building, and we need also to bring equipment, and so they start very often from scratch to build a kind of database. So of course they have all the maps, and but for instance they don't have big printers to print at that scale. It's a bit more complicated, but at least they have all the maps. All our socio-economic data also, it's more simple to give an Excel file or whatever. So this, for all the departments there, forestry, agriculture, are very happy with this kind of data because they have nothing. You have to realize that in such areas, they are so happy to see us giving any kind of data. They have absolutely nothing. And here at C4, it's already the case, but it will be more now when we just finish to clean the data. It will be also available to everybody.
Okay, thanks. It's an interesting and important discussion. Unfortunately, we have to end here. I thank everybody for being here and for contributing to the debate. And let's thank once more the speaker, Yves, for his talk today by giving him a hand.